This is the story of 1982 Ossining High School football season. It was a year that saw the Indians struggle through the first half of the season, but finish strong to suggest that winning football at Ossining may not be all the way back, but it's on its way. Winning football at Ossining is not unusual. In the 1960s, OHS teams went 4 wins, 30 losses, and 6 ties. In the 70s, the Indians were 45 wins, 32 losses, and 6 ties. But after 2 years of the 1980s, Ossining football was at 1 win, 15 losses, and 2 ties. The 1982 season saw a new head coach at the helm, and Ossining fans speculated on how the Indians would do, considering that they were coming off a winless 1981 campaign. The club's first game of the season was at Carmel, September 25th, 1982. The attitude and spirit of the players seemed to be much improved over last year, and 2 days before the season opener, at a Thursday afternoon practice, Bob to the team on behalf of the school and the community.
Wish you luck. Carmel on Saturday. You're going to have a big following up there. You got a lot of people rooting for you. I think with Mr. Wheeler as your coach, I see a lot of differences on the team, especially the kind of spirit that you guys are showing. Good luck on Saturday.
The Indians were going to need it. The players all agreed that the attitude was much different this year, and first-year coach Gene Wheeler felt that was a beginning.
I know that we're going to win some ball games for Ossining fans, and the most important thing, the kids really believe they can do it, and that's most important. Attitude's the most important thing right now.
But attitude is one thing, and winning games is another. September 25th, 1982, the Indians march into Carmel High School to play the Rams, and quickly fell behind 21-0 in the first half as Carmel quarterback Chris DeBellis hit split end Chris Ryan for the first 2 scores, and then George White picked off a Dan Rickey pass and went into the end zone to make it 21-0 Rams. For the first time ever, the Ossining games were televised on McLean Cable Channel 26. Video Gem Productions produced the games. Brian Heyman and John Shaman were the statisticians. Bill Crawford was on camera, and the announcing team was Mike Jamay and Tony DeMichael. They were calling the shots when the Indians got on the board late in the first half with what was to be their only score, a touchdown pass from Ossining quarterback Dan Rickey to junior end Ed Walker. Tap 21-0, Carmel leading Ossining. Rickey faking, throwing long down the sideline, complete! Beautifully thrown pass to number 85, Eddie Walker. Touchdown, Ossining! The Indians went on to lose their opener 28-6. Co-captain Anthony Derpich was voted the defensive player of the game, and running back Nick DeCiccio got the nod on offense. The team had to regroup because their next opponent was a tough Horace Greeley ball club at Horace Greeley. Game number 2 of the season was played on October 2nd, 1982 at Horace Greeley High School, and the clubs played to a scoreless first quarter. But on the first play of the second quarter, the Indians were forced to kick the ball away from deep in their own territory. They failed to execute, and the Quakers had the opportunity they needed to put some points on the board. A few plays later, they did, as quarterback Dan James handed off to running back Bill Bellamy. The half ended 6-0. It was the same score after 3 quarters. But on the first play of the fourth, James hit receiver Greg Karlick on a 52-yard completion. That set up Greeley's second score as James ran it in from the 1. The 2-point conversion was good, and with 8 minutes to go in the game, Greeley led 14-0. 4 minutes later, the Indians came back as quarterback Dan Rickey hit Ed Walker with a big gainer. Rickey is 2 for 8 passing for 9 yards, avoids trouble, throwing deep. And Ed Walker's got it for an Ossining completion at the 20-yard line. Seconds later, Rickey hit receiver Dan Rivey with a touchdown pass that put Ossining on the board. First and 10 now for OHS, but we move under the 5-minute mark. Rickey throwing on every down, has time, throwing into the end zone, touchdown! Dan Rivi, a 5'10", 160-pound senior.
A two-point conversion by Timmy Sinclair followed, and all of a sudden it was 14-8. But the Quakers managed to score some key first downs to wind down the clock. They sealed the game when Tony Napoli caught a touchdown pass with less than a minute remaining. The final score, Greeley 20, Ossining 8. Dan Rickey was voted MVP on offense, and John Pottinger got the nod on defense. The Indians had dropped two straight, but the Greeley game was really closer than the score indicated, and the Quakers were the team. So the feeling was that the Ossining Indians were improving. They were also playing their home games on a new field. The Indians needed something new. They hadn't won a ball game since back in 1980. What's more, Game 3 against Walter Panis High School on October 9th was the Indians' home opener. It was their homecoming. There was a pregame parade, pregame ceremonies with the great Ossining players of the 1940s being introduced. The OHS marching unit was at their best, and the bleachers were packed with Ossining fans who were anxious for a victory. But it wasn't to be, as the Panthers struck early on a 30-yard run by number 42, Frank Maresco. The two-point conversion from quarterback Joe Ruyak to wide receiver Mark Hayes made it 8-0 Panis, and the Indians were faced with an uphill battle again. But in the second quarter, to the delight of the homecoming crowd, the Indians got right back in it.
4 minutes remaining first half. Rickey handing the ball off. Touchdown, Ossining's Timmy Sinclair. The hole opening up off left guard by the Ossining offensive line. Sinclair snaking his way through and into the end zone, and Ossining has their first touchdown of the game. Good blocking up front by the Indian forward wall on offense.
The two-point conversion was no good, however, and Panis led 8-6. But near the end of the first half, the Panthers expanded their lead on a 42-yard pass play from Ruyak to halfback Richard Shelton. They missed the two-point conversion, and it was 14-6 as the half ended. Early in the third quarter, Panis picked up two more points when the Indians' Ed Walker was tackled in his own end zone, attempting to return a punt. It was then 16-6. Shortly after, Ruyak hit Mark Hayes with the final score of the game, and the Indians' homecoming was spoiled to the tune of 23-6. Keith Fonville was voted the offensive MVP of the game, and co-captain Ron Robinson took the award for his defensive play. The Indians were now 0-3 and had gone 18 games in a row without a victory. The guys were still enthusiastic, but game number 4, played on October 16, 1982, at home at the Ann Dorner Middle School field, was against powerful Harrison, and the Huskies came out smoking with a first quarter touchdown on the ground. In the second quarter, the Huskies went to the air and the Indians were down 14-0. Late in the first half, the Indians' Doug Grimalia intercepted a Harrison pass that set up a minute later what looked like an Ossining score when Ed Walker caught a Dan Rickey pass in the end zone. But a penalty nullified the touchdown, and it was 14-0 at the half. In the third quarter, the Huskies' excellent ground attack led to their third touchdown of the game, and it was 20-0. In the final period, the Indians mounted a drive that led to their only score of the game.
Okay, there's that short hike back to Nick DeCiccio, and he rambles into Husky territory, and a penalty marker down.
That penalty moved the ball to the Harrison 30. A few plays later, quarterback Dan Rickey hit Timmy Sinclair to put the Indians on the Harrison 5-yard line. A minute later, the Indians had 6 points.
There's a pitch back to Timmy Sinclair, number 22, looking to run wide, cuts inside. Touchdown for Ossining. Nice run there by number 22, Timmy Sinclair.
Tim was later voted the offensive player of the game. Dan Rickey made a great run to add 2 points to the touchdown, but the powerful Huskies scored at the end of the game, added a two-point conversion to make the final score 28-8. John Pottinger was cited for his defensive play in that Harrison game. The Indians would hit rock bottom the following week. Game number 5 of the season was played at home on October 23rd. The opponent was Portchester, and the Indians were losing 14-0 late in the first half. The following 2 minutes characterized the Indians' first half of the 1982 football season. Martin White in the shotgun. Has the time to throw. Throwing deep. Eddie Walker's open. He's got it for an Ossining reception. And oh, wait a minute. He fumbled the ball. And Porchester's got it. And Ed Walker is claiming that the play was ruled dead, but I didn't hear a whistle, and it's first and 10 for the Rams. Very disheartening at this point for the Ossining Indians.
Right, if you don't hear a whistle, you should keep both arms wrapped around the ball as tightly as possible. Mike, it appeared on the play that the coverage had caught up and they were really going sideways along the sidelines. Walker's forward progress indeed seemed to be stopped, but you can't play referee out there. You have to wait for the whistle before carrying the ball loosely in any sort of way. And as a result, he probably relaxed the grip. The Porchester defender on the play, we couldn't see who it was, probably alertly got his arm in there and wrenched the ball out of there. So it's just one frustrating thing after another for the Indians. And when things seem to go good, something pops up and just knocks them back. When it rains, it pours, as they say.
Well, this is the way it's been all year for the Indians. They've been in the games. As a matter of fact, we talked pregame with Gene Wheeler, and I said it from an announcing standpoint, we felt that the Indians have really been in all the games that they've played. It's not as if we get these 48-0 scores. I mean, at least in the first half, they seem to be more in the ball game. And then, as Coach Wheeler said himself, the club just seems to disappear.
Just mistakes. Mistakes that just pile on in one way or another to eventually cause their downfall.
Conklin is back to throw, number 11, throwing deep. He's got a man open, Francella. He may go all the way, 20, 10, touchdown, Porchester. Pete Francella, number 23. A 65-yard pass play.
Ossining would go no lower. Coach Gene Wheeler commented after the season that at halftime of that game against Porchester, the Indians made up their minds that they would no longer make those mental mistakes and give it all they had to get on that winning track. They held the Rams scoreless in the second half, but the game ended 21-0 Porchester. The MVPs in that game were Fred Weeks and Donovan Guy. A few days after the Porchester game, it was learned that Carmel had forfeited their game against the Indians because they used an ineligible player. So the Indians were 1-4. But Ossining needed that first victory on the field. And on October 30th, up in Cross River, New York, against John Jay, they almost got it. For the first time, the Indians were the first team on the board. The camera was blocked on the play, but the Indians took the lead in the first quarter, 6-0.
White to Baron Powell. Now he's throwing back across field. Open is number 43, touchdown. Martin White, the quarterback. Right, what a play by the Indians.
Right out of the Don Shula playbook, if you will, Mike. He gave the pitch back and then ran a pattern down the left sideline and caught the John Jay defense napping and made a good play to shuffle his feet and keep it in bounds just in time.
The Indians couldn't convert on the two-point attempt, and that proved later to be a big play in the game. A tough Indian defense held John Jay scoreless for the rest of the half and through the third quarter. With 8.5 minutes left in the game, the Indians held again and John Jay was forced to punt. But instead of going into the end zone, the ball stopped on the 2-yard line where Nick DeCiccio could only advance it a few yards. A few plays later, the Indians quick kicked themselves out of deep trouble. But John Jay had excellent field position at the Ossining 34. A determined drive ended 6 plays later when John Jay scored. It was 6-6. But the blue and white John Jay Indians kicked the extra point and took a slim 1-point lead. With under 3 minutes to go in the game, the Indians still had a chance. Quarterback Martin White hit Timmy Sinclair, who advanced the ball to the John Jay 41-yard line. But on the very next play, White's arm was hit as he released the ball. The pass was intercepted, and the Indians dropped a 1-point decision, 7-6. In that game, John Ryan was voted the MVP for his defensive play. Nick DeCiccio was given the award for his performance on offense. The Indians had come so close. They were now 1-5, but without a victory on the field. November 6, 1982, Saunders High School, Yonkers, New York. The Indians dominated the Blue Devils, but were unable to cash in and score a touchdown. This game saw a spectacular performance by number 44, defensive back Greg Morris. Four times he intercepted Blue Devil passes. His third interception came with less than 2 minutes to go in a scoreless ball game.
Here's an interesting play on fourth down. Kenny is back there, and he's operating from the shotgun, throwing long, and it's intercepted by Morris again. His third of the day. Greg Morris, number 44, running down the right sideline, is finally knocked out of bounds.
The very next play would be the biggest of the year for the 1982 Ossining High School football team.
Couple of tackles, and very importantly, got out of bounds to save Ossining. A timeout on the play, about 37 yards away.
So Ossining will have the ball from their own 38-yard line, a 30-yard return by Greg Morris, number 44. Very little time remaining. Ricky in the shotgun calling signals, has a time to throw. Running out of the pocket, throwing long down the right sideline. McBride is after it. He's got it. Touchdown, Ossining.
The two-point conversion was no good, but the Indians and their fans finally had something to really cheer about. Now, if they could only hold on. With time running out, the Blue Devils went for broke.
40 seconds left in this ball game. Second down, and about 15 yards to go. Kenny to number 9. Don Schreiber throwing deep, and it's intercepted for the fourth time by number 44, Greg Morris. Four interceptions in one game, and he's finally knocked down. Look at the Ossining ball players and Coach Gene Wheeler and company. Unbelievable, four interceptions in one game. Number 44, Greg Morris. And it's only fitting, Tony, that's his number, 44. The game is over, and Ossining defeats Saunders 6-0. Look at this Ossining High School ball club.
The Indians were now 2-5 and had finally won a game on the field. Greg Morris was voted the defensive player of the game, and Tommy McBride was given the award for his play on the offensive side. The victory that was so needed had been recorded, and after a few days of enjoying that long-awaited win, it was time to start thinking about the upcoming confrontation with the Peekskill Red Devils. November 13, 1982, Ann M. Dorner Middle School, Ossining, New York. The 1970 undefeated team on hand to watch the 1982 Indians take on a 3-4 Peekskill ball club. In the third quarter, after a scoreless first half, the confident Indians struck.
The ball is spotted at the Peekskill 31-yard line. Ricky pitching back to Timmy Sinclair. Sinclair down the right sideline. Sinclair may go all the way. Touchdown, Ossining. Timmy Sinclair got out of the reach of Craig Jacobs, number 33, and went all the way for an Ossining touchdown. Look at this Ossining crowd.
And Mike, as Sinclair broke into the end zone, over at the right side, four Peekskill defenders on one knee looked forlornly downfield. It was those four guys who blew the tackle, various tackles on Sinclair. Excellent individual effort.
And Ossining leads it now, 6-0. Here's the attempt for the two-point conversion, and they have it. I believe that was number 41, Baron Powell. Ossining quickly, 8-0 over Peekskill.
But the Indians were stunned on the very next play as the Red Devils came right back.
Ossining leads it now, 8-0. We've got about 6 minutes remaining here in the third quarter. And Freddie Weeks, number 82, kicks it in a line drive fashion. Number 25 on it there, Torrey McKenna. And wait a minute, he breaks loose. Look at this, McKenna's at midfield to the 40, to the 30-yard line, 20, 10, touchdown, Peekskill. And no penalty markers are down. He broke right out of the pack.
The two-point conversion attempt was no good, and the Indians led by 2 points, 8-6. But in the fourth quarter, the Indians expanded that lead.
Ricky calling signals. Let's see what happens here. And Ossining touchdown! Nick DeCiccio, number 32. And the Indians have a lot to cheer about thus far this afternoon. Nick DeCiccio from about 2.5 yards out, and Ossining now leads it 14-6.
Excellent effort by DeCiccio. He was hit before he got to the goal line, but just plowed forward, and before he was knocked down, extended the ball to make sure he broke the so-called invisible pane of glass for the touchdown.
Here's Ricky throwing into the end zone, complete. What a catch that time by Dan Rivey. Another two-point conversion.
Absolutely, Mike, and what a play by Rivey. He was about 9.5 yards deep in the end zone, went way up in the air, snatched the ball with two hands, and came down with both feet just barely scraping the turf to remain in bounds and have it ruled a legal catch. Indians just doing what they have to do at the crucial moments, and really, they've controlled the ball game, Mike.
The Red Devils tried to get back in it, but when they did, the Indians, Greg Morris, was there for an interception. Shortly, it was all over.
Down drive of theirs that gave them the victory over the Indians a couple of weeks back. The defense just coming into its own, the ball club coming into its own.
And the game is over! And the Ossining Indians have defeated the Peekskill Red Devils here at the Ann M. Dorner Middle School in Ossining, New York, by a score of 16-6, and Gene Wheeler being carried on the shoulders of his ball club as you see both teams congratulating each other.
Ossining has won back-to-back. Who would have believed it? Absolutely, Mike. Just a tremendous turnaround by the Indians to get these two wins after having so much tough luck in some earlier games this year. But they just continue to bang away there, just put it together. As we noted during the first six games of the year, their practices remained enthusiastic despite the defeats. They looked to highlight redeeming aspects of their defeats, knowing that eventually it would come to victory. And they have done it twice in a row now. And this has to get them really charged up for the biggie next week in North Tarrytown against you-know-who.
The Sleepy Hollow Ball Club.
That Sleepy Hollow Ball Club was ready and waiting for the Indians. In the Peekskill game, the MVPs were Frank Fiore on defense and Timmy Sinclair on offense. Everyone knew that Sleepy Hollow and Ossining were arch rivals. Some of the games that they've played through the years were legendary in terms of excitement and suspense. The game that took place on November 20th, 1982 at Sleepy's Doc Rasbeck Field was a back-and-forth thriller that has to go down as one of the most memorable of all time. The entire Ossining team played their hearts out, led by Dan Rickey, Ed Walker, and Dan Rivey on offense, and Anthony Derpich, Ron Robinson, and Ellery Crawford on defense. This was the game to remember. Neither team could score in the first quarter, but early in the second, the Headless Horsemen were in deep Ossining territory and attempted a field goal.
John Powers, number 36, the try for the field goal. Frank Schartner is the holder with 9:08 remaining in the first half. Here's a three-point attempt. It is up and it is good.
27-yard boot by Powers, splitting the uprights, and the Headless Horsemen have drawn first blood. But of course, 3 points are certainly better than seven from the Ossining standpoint.
The Indians were having trouble getting untracked, and on their next series were forced to punt. It was then time for Sleepy's fine running back, Alex Adair, to go to work.
Third down, we'll call it a yard and a half. And there's Adair, number 42. He may go all the way. Adair to the 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Sleepy Hollow.
Quickly, it was 9-0 Headless Horseman. The extra point attempt was no good. The Indians knew that they couldn't fall too far behind against Sleepy Hollow, and they started to strike back.
Ricky faking and throwing down the sideline, and Walker's got it for a completion. Great play by the Ossining Indians, and Walker rambles to the Ossining 44-yard line. A 41-yard pass play from quarterback Dan Rickey to Ed Walker.
It was the first of some outstanding catches by the Ossining junior end. And after a few penalties, the Indians were faced with third and long from their own 29.
Ricky again in the shotgun. In the backfield, Timmy Sinclair and Nick DeCiccio. Ricky with the time, throwing long. He's throwing this way downfield. Ed Walker's got it. What a catch by Ed Walker, number 85. Tackle finally by Mike Marchese, number 16 of Sleepy Hollow. Two big catches by the junior end, Ed Walker, number 85.
A few plays later, the Indians were faced with another third down situation.
Third down and six from the Ossining 25-yard line. Ricky in the shotgun. He's got time, now running away. Ricky now throwing deep, and it's touchdown, Ossining High School. Ed Walker with another phenomenal catch. Three spectacular catches by Ed Walker here in the second quarter, and Ossining is on the board.
The Indians had cut Sleepy's lead to 3 points, and with time running out in the first half, it looked as if they were actually going to take the lead.
Back to throw. It's quarterback Pell throwing, and it is intercepted by Frank Fiore. Down the far sideline, Fiore at the 20-yard line, and knocked out of bounds. Great defensive play, Tony, by Frank Fiore.
But the Sleepy defense held, and at halftime, the Headless Horseman led 9-6. With half the third quarter gone and the Indians with the ball deep in their own territory, down by three, Sleepy Hollow came up with a big defensive play.
From the 22-yard line, Ricky this time back to throw, looking for Ed Walker. He is really popped, and picking it up is number 75. Big Rudy Mallow, touchdown, Sleepy Hollow.
The extra point attempt was good, and it was 16-6 Sleepy Hollow. The Indians again couldn't move the ball, but neither could Sleepy Hollow. With time running out in the third quarter, a high snap gave the Indians great field position. But Dan Rivey just couldn't hold on to a Dan Ricky pass, and the third quarter ended with Sleepy Hollow maintaining that 10-point lead. Early in the fourth quarter, Dan Rivey would more than make up for that incompletion.
Ricky again in the shotgun, fakes once, throwing long, and Ed Walker, can he get a third one? Rivey has it! Rivey going in, touchdown, Ossining! The ball was tipped. Touchdown, Dan Rivey!
The Indians had come back again. The margin was now only 4 points. The two-point conversion try was no good, and it remained 16-12. But just two plays and 24 seconds later, the Headless Horseman's Alex Adair broke loose.
Jeff Pell handing off to Alex Adair, streaking through. He's on the near side, and it's possible he could go all the way. Knocked out of bounds, finally, by Greg Morris at the Ossining 2-yard line. What an electrifying run by number 42, Alex Adair.
On the very next play, Sleepy Hollow scored.
Just when it seemed the Indians were going to come back, here's Ian O'Reilly. Touchdown, Sleepy Hollow.
It was 22-12. The extra point was no good. Both teams were forced to punt on their next series, but when the Indians got the ball back, they were down by 10 with only 5 minutes left in the game. They started to come back again.
We've got a long ways to go, and they're down by 10 points. We're under the 5 minute mark in the game. Ricky throwing to Tommy McBride, complete.
On the very next play, it was 6 points for the Indians.
6 yard pickup by McBride, second down, 4 yards to go. Dan Ricky throwing, and Rivey has it down the right sideline. He might go all the way, 20, 10, 5, touchdown. Dan Rivey, an unbelievable run for a touchdown for the Indians. After catching that pass thrown by Dan Ricky, a 62-yard pass completion. What a ball game.
What a ball game it was. But the two-point attempt was no good, and time was running out on the Indians. 4 minutes left and down by four at 22-18. They had to hold the Headless Horseman to get one more chance at winning the game, and they did. But by the time the Indians got possession, the clock was down to 2 minutes, 38 seconds left in the game, and the Indians had to go 85 yards to pay dirt. It didn't take them long to start moving up the field.
Okay, first down, long yardage now. Ricky throwing. And Ed Walker, did he catch that? I won't believe it. This is unbelievable. A 28-yard reception by Ed Walker in heavy traffic. 2 minutes, 23 seconds left in the game. The ball is moved to the Ossining 35-yard line. First and 10 Indians.
But a few plays later, Dan Ricky was sacked, setting up a fourth down and long yardage for the Indians. The following do-or-die situation will go down as one of the great clutch plays in Ossining football history.
There you see part of the crowd here at Sleepy Hollow High School this afternoon. Fourth down and 10 for the Ossining Indians. This is it. Ricky is going to put it up in the air again, throwing long. Ed Walker has got it. I don't believe it. I don't believe that, Ed Walker.
Two plays later, there was 50 seconds left. The Indians on the sleepy 13 with a chance to win it.
50 seconds left. The clock continues to move. The ball is spotted at the 13-yard line. Ricky in the shotgun. He has it. Back to throw. Has plenty of time. Throwing into the end zone. Ed Walker's got it. He's out of bounds. Ed Walker is out of bounds, according to the officials. Do not score the touchdown here at Sleepy Hollow.
Another incomplete pass followed, and that set the stage for another great clutch play by the Ossining Indians.
Let's call it the 13-yard line, 38 seconds left. Sleepy Hollow leads it 22-18. This is it for the Indians, fourth and 10. They've got to get to the 3-yard line for a first down, but I'm sure Dan Ricky and company is thinking touchdown. Ricky with time. Ricky running out of the pocket. Ricky's gonna try for it himself. He may have the first down, but he's short of a touchdown. 23 seconds left. We're just gonna have to wait and see. I believe Ricky has the first down, but not a touchdown.
Dan Ricky did have the first down, but not the touchdown.
23 seconds left in the game.
It was goal to go on the Sleepy Hollow 1-yard line. But the Indians couldn't push it across. And in an unbelievable finish, as time was running out, they gave it one more try.
7 seconds left. He hits the line. And Sleepy Hollow may have recovered. The game is... Sleepy Hollow has defeated Ossining High School 22-18.
A heartbreaking loss to end the season. But in 1982, the Indians showed that by sticking in there when the going got tough, a team can turn things around. In 1982, the Indians broke a long winless streak and finished the season at 3-6. Congratulations to Ossining High School and the Ossining High Football Program. May the spirit and positive attitude of the 1982 ball club serve as an example for football teams in the future at good old OHS.